Okay, let's talk to Thalana Makarath. Or Runnin Prince. You see a slender woman covered in worn brown robes leaning over the fire, the cowl pulled low over her head. Her skin is a dark bronze color. Here to interrogate me? She pulls back her cowl enough for you to see that her long hair is more silver than brown, and the years of life on the road are apparent in her face. She looks weary and exhausted, except for her eyes, which burn like golden fire. I'm Thalana Makarath. What are you... Her eyes alight on your tattoo, and she hisses. Skist. You bastards are all over the place here, eh? Look, I can't tell you anything, all right? We're done with fighting. She thinks, let her drag us back. We'll take off again. We're not going back to that hell. What are you talking about? She looks confused for a moment. You're a cast-off. So, either you're here to drag us back, or kill us. She turns to her side and pauses, as if listening to words that you cannot hear. Then she responds, No, I suppose you're right. Still, she's a cast-off. Who are you talking to? My men. Zad reminded me not all cast-offs are endless battle, but Timpo wants me to be careful with you. She holds up a finger. People have said they're not there because they can't see them. But they can see you, so let's not have that conversation. She settles back. So, are you here to kill us? Tell on us? She thinks, they say that of most of my crew. Not Denovan or Luca, though. No, we can actually see them. Ugh. There's only one option. I have no part in the endless battle, but answer some questions for me. She breathes out, a low whistle. All right. Good. Sure. We'll answer anything we can. Tell me about yourself. Me, Denovan, Luca, Timpo, Zad, and the rest, they're my crew, my men. We're just trying to find a way home from the endless battle. We came through Koln, but... She waves a hand at the pile of rubble. It's not exactly a forgiving route. Just trying to figure out where we go next. Her sleeve slips with her gesture. You can see that her skin does not simply look metallic. It is metal. She catches you looking and tugs her sleeve back down, annoyed. Okay, so not only are there two others that we can't see, but all the rest, whoever they are. Because we can only see these three. Not all these. If they are really there. A price of the endless battle. One of the reasons I left. I used to think I'd earn glory there. Thought my nano skills would propel me high. Only room in that exalted air is for cast-offs. The rest of us bleed while you lot laugh. That's why we got out. I just want to get home, share the stories my friends and I have earned. We're not looking for trouble. Not anymore. Had too much. What are you doing here? Camping, trying to figure out our next steps. Came through Koln with reluctance and decided it wasn't the best place to plan. Thought we'd get a clearer perspective down here. He frowns. Instead, there's some sort of cult war going on. We've got to leave sooner rather than later. She nods her head as if receiving compliments from an unseen audience. Came through Koln and camped here for a while, getting ready to leave. What can you tell me about the endless battle? Oh no. No, no. It's too much. Too much horror. She shuts her eyes tight and shakes her head. When she opens them again, her eyes are cold. You want to know about the endless battle? Talk to my crew. Hear it from those who ran. Why they ran. Then maybe I'll tell you what I think. Can't say I blame her, Tiber mutters. Horror puts it far too lightly. I talked to Luca. Just Luca. If you can get more than one of them to talk, maybe I will too. Why won't you talk to me about the endless battle again? Because it's not worth reliving. Talk to my crew. If you can get their stories, I'll give you mine. I only see Denovan and Luca here. Where are Timpo and Zad? She closes her eyes and pinches the bridge of her nose. If you can't see them, it's no fault of mine. Frankly, they're lucky they don't have to talk to you. Calistia whispers to you. This poor woman sees nothing. None but her exist in these other realities. She's suffering from shock and guilt. Looks like you've been resting here a while. Is it safe? She chews the question over a while, then shrugs. It's safe for us, she says sourly. For you? She eyes her companions and they give a slight nod. We can make it safe for you. It'll cost, though. 100 shins. I don't need it yet. Forget it. I had other questions. All right. I'll try to talk to these other two some more. Aye, for now. Miss Denovan will talk to us now. His eyes flicker over you briefly, and then he's back to staring at the distance. Thalana said you're deserters from the endless battle. Denovan stops breathing. The smoke falls from his nerveless fingers, and his face goes slack with terror. He starts shaking, and a single sob breaks from his throat before he snaps back to reality. The flat expression settles back onto his face, and he picks up his dropped smoke. He takes a deliberate drag, and only then does his tension ease. No. He thinks, Timpo, Zad, oh gods, Bracieth, why? Can't you tell me anything about the endless battle? His breath hitches, but he controls his reactions this time. No. See it yourself. How would I do that? Let's try Luca again. Oh my god, it keeps getting stuck on everybody.
Fair enough.
You return. I offer greetings again. Thalana says you're deserters. He frowns. Yes, we have left our posts, but I do not believe we have deserted. I believe we have become aware. If the battle is endless, then our struggle means nothing. If our struggle means nothing, why should we continue to struggle? He thinks, money and glory were our reasons. Were. I don't remember being so foolish. For power, for glory. That's a good point. He nods. We thought so as well. Thalana? They wouldn't say anything to me, and I'm stuck on your guy again. Back again? What do you want? I've talked to Luca, and I tried to talk to Denovan about the endless battle. Good enough. They were normal people once. Ordinary, thrill-seeking kids. Look at them now. Most wars, she starts, a group of people march in with their artifacts, gravity, light pulse, time benders, and march back out. Endless battle is like that, but going on for centuries. The endless war from Planescape Torment? Between the devils and the demons, hell and... Is it? I forget, one is hell? Or it's different circles of hell? I forget. Endless battle is like that, but going on for centuries. Think of what it does to the landscape. Think of what it does to the psychic terrain. Think of what it does to your friends. She waves at her nearby companions, her gesture continuing to colleagues unseen. And when you're vermin to the people who run the war, when you've got no hope to survive, and you can feel realities collapsing around you, when you see wormholes open up and monsters walk through, when the air is toxic and the ground melts, and you feel your mind assaulted. But it's not personal. It's not someone who wants your destruction in particular. You're just inconvenient to them. Your death is another number, a way to measure their success. It's hell. A business like hell. Sounds like lawful evil. And you did it. Cast-offs. You could stop if you wanted, but you don't. Or maybe you don't care. I mean, when you've made statistics of your enemies, faceless foes whose existence you can erase without qualm, you're not just hurting them. You're hurting yourself, the way you see the world. Soon everything is conflict and pain. All that matters is your success. And you've killed yourself, and you don't even know it. She wipes a tear away. It ruins everything. Everyone it touches. I said my piece. I'm not saying it again. Farewell for now. Aye for now. Ooh, look at that.
Yes, now.
Too far away. Oh, and there's loot. So, I guess we need to get back down.
Why not?
Why not get back down? Because I think the only way to get back down is through that portal.
Allow me. Naturally.
Naturally. Okay.
Fair enough.
So that goes up there. And then there's... Look at that thing shuddering. Oh, there's this? Oh. How do I get up there?
I'm ready. I'm always ready.
Yeah, Kolo is like Calistige.
Yes.
So I'm thinking this possibly goes up here, maybe?
Fair enough.
So let's try this thing.
Ready.
There's a tear in space here, like the patch of darkness through the entrance to the valley. A patch of white light hangs in the air, like glare bouncing off a window. Except there is no window. Within the light you see a play of shadows, like those on a wall opposite a door when someone walks past outside. Except there is no wall. But there might be a door. There is certainly a breeze coming from inside the shimmer, and echoes of sounds you are not hearing around you. If you step through, you might go anywhere, or maybe nowhere. It could just be a trick of the light. The patch of light seems to follow you as you walk around it. It is always facing you. It doesn't look like much, just a trick of the light, but you get the strangest feeling that it's watching you. The way it moves and pulses, it feels alive. If you look into the light looks back at you. Then you go blind. Let's walk into the light. No, Carol Ann! Get away from the light! You step into the glare and it envelops you, blinding you, then dissolves you into twinkling motes, drifting in a sphere of light. The light carries you through cold darkness, weightless, bodiless, selfless, toward another patch of glare. Then suddenly, you are somewhere else. Whoosh. Why do we fly back down here? cool. Ooh, we get looch. Check out some looch. 25 shins. And an amplified encephalic rush. You know, 6 points of intellect. I think we have one of those already. Cool. Ooh, that one's amplified though. Oh, we got an amplified one. So these heal 3, and this other one heals 6. Can I move crap around? Can I? So I can't, like, actually make it go up. Just kind of annoying. Ah! Yeah, good enough. You haven't figured out who's where these two rings. I'll do it at some point.
I have a
weird idea about it that probably isn't real. Silk ribbons and banners flap softly against stone. These decorations are recent, perhaps several years old, but like everything else here, they've been forgotten.
In an instant.
You're gonna love it in an instant. Oh, we got a thingy. Ooh, interact. I don't know, do I want to interact?
I'm going.
Is this the... Ooh, this is the alcove he was afraid of, that he said he wasn't afraid of. This small alcove is about the size of a small hovel. Its sole virtue is that it is a shelter from the wind and from the sight lines of casual passersby. The runes carved above its entrance fill your mind with a wordless message of catastrophic danger. He's gonna freak out. The dust inside the alcove is undisturbed apart from a set of footprints that circles the interior. Their owner appears to have curled up in a corner under a ledge containing a small ebony box. The dust on that ledge has also been disturbed. Someone removes something long and thin, like a blade, from this place. In its place is a crudely carved herder's crook. Callistes picks up the box and her eyes widen momentarily. This is not ornamental. It was built to hold something dangerous within. Something alive, by the look, and some fool cracked it open. It's worthless now. She dusts her hands off. None of my sisters see anything useful here. Let's go. She shivers a bit. None of us would like to spend any more time here. Well, what is it? We just got a feeling of something? Who was here? Erritis? Erritis cradles his forehead in his hands. He mouths the word no, then swallows, shaking his head. He seems smaller than you recall. I don't like this place. His voice is a whisper. His hands fall to his eyes, and he touches them as if they are in pain. Are we leaving? I want to leave. He thinks, we should not be here. We tried to stop him. You failed. What's wrong, Erritis? Nothing. He swallows hard. I don't want to say. Not here. Please. I'm begging you. Let's go. No. Tell me now. I remember this place. His voice cracks again. As it runs dry, the glow seems to evaporate before his face. There was someone else. A boy. Erritis's features soften. He was tired. Scared. Not at all like me. He came to this place, and when he fell asleep there, he never woke up. The sleep buried him, and he screamed. Still screams. Erritis' voice cracks again, and he swallows. I can hear it, when all things are quiet. Who is that boy? Some farm boy, a herder. He chose the wrong place to sleep, the wrong time to follow his curiosity. He's frightened all the time now. He raps on his forehead with his knuckles. Who was he? Who was he? And then... I don't remember, he screams. It was a nightmare, a stupid story, and nothing heroic happened. It was a waste of time, and I don't know why I remember. So you do remember? He presses the heels of his trembling hands against his eyes. Look inside the ebony box. There is no sign of what this empty box once held, but you do note a carving of an eye at the bottom of the box, with a pupil made of two crimson concentric rings. If you squint, you can just make out a human figure at the center of the eye, holding a sword in the air. Erritis groans, and you look over. An untroubled smile graces his face, but you notice that one of his eyes is watering. Okay, I'm gonna ask again. Erritis, are you all right? Yes, very, he says, nodding at you. A tear streaks down his narrow cheek and around his cheerful grin. But bored here, now that you ask. We should leave. We should leave now. He whistles quietly to himself and looks away. You find nothing new inside the box, just the etched eye at the bottom of a tiny sword waving, a tiny sword-waving figure at the center of a two-ringed pupil. Okay, so obviously he was the farm boy. The symbol, I guess, is who he became, in a way, with the help of whoever these two beings are inside his head. So is he doing their bidding? Are they controlling him somehow? Is he even fully aware of anything that is going on within him? Pick up the herder's crook.
Making a note.
Quest updated. The Lost Shepherd. You stretch out your hand to take the crook. Beside you, Erritis moans. A wave of pale fire explodes from the crook and everything goes white. You hear screaming, perhaps Erritis's, perhaps your own. Thunderous voices bellow beyond the hissing wall of that hissing wail of that endless ivory wall, and something is rushing at you, something that you can't see. A fistful of senses, emotions, memories, and fear strikes your mind, driving you back a step along the dusty floor of the alcove. Something has changed inside you, inside the labyrinth. You hear a voice in your mind, a voice very much like Erritis's, but small and afraid. You look over at him. Erritis is staring at the shelf, hands slack at his side. The glow is nowhere to be seen, and he looks weathered, weary, old. You follow his gaze. The herder's crook is gone. What just happened? I went somewhere, he mumbles without looking at you. I stayed here in my amazing heroic body, but I went somewhere else. Without looking at you, his hand lifts from his side and points at your forehead. He does not seem to be aware that his hand is doing this. Then his glow returns like the sun rising behind a hill and swallows him. He smiles, dropping his rebellious hand. Why are we just standing here? He says, looking around. We should be fighting, feasting, jumping from roof to roof. Let's go find some roofs. Is this a roof? He thinks, what happened? The hero's companion took us to the alcove. We feel strange. We feel weaker. Huh. They feel weaker. Erritis? When are we ever going to find out what's going on with you?
Why? Why are we here again?
He thinks, you have returned at long last. Ignore your pain and push on. This is your moment. This, Erritis begins, brightening. This is my moment, isn't it? Do I get to die here in glorious combat? Oh, am I fighting an army? Let's get right to the chase here. Your thoughts told you to ignore your pain. What's wrong? Wrong? Erritis chuckles through his teeth. Nothing's wrong. I'm a living legend. I can't complain about anything. I can't. It is intensifying. His glow intensifies and he straightens. He casts a look around, sags, and frowns at you. I hate to criticize you, but we should already be having a desperate last stand. It's awfully quiet here. You should have planned things better. You don't actually want a last stand, do you? What a silly question, he says, shaking his head. Of course I do. How else am I supposed to survive against the odds? What happened to that shepherd's crook I found in the alcove, anyway? A shepherd probably took it, he says, looking around with a scowl. Took it into a dark place. Maybe a labyrinth. Maybe they took it there. His fist is trembling at his side, and his aura is fluctuating wildly. Yeah, it is. Look at that. He or they thinks he is talking about the echo. The what? Make him stop talking immediately. He flinches, it stopped blinking, as though someone has slapped his forehead, and the glow returns to its normal brilliance. Shepherds aren't interesting, he says slowly. We should stop talking about them and where they're hiding now. Same question, same answers as before. What about you guys? So let's see if they say anything different about Erritis.
Yes, lad.
Given the events. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, cool theme, but nothing new. Hey, friend, come over here. Tantalum? Why not? He says. You seek answers, I can tell. Alright, Tantalum. What's up? An old, battered-looking swordsman in dull gray armor stands here, whistling tunelessly. His hands hover near the hilt of his well-used sword. Scars wreathe his face, and what you took for a helmet reveals itself to be a dome of metal grafted to him. He smiles at you as you approach. How do, stranger? I'm Tantalum. You know Tantalum? It's a metal. Sticks to flesh. He wraps his knuckles on the dome. Chirurgeon says they had to cut a chunk of my brain out, too. So I lost my name and my history, and, well, I took the name of the stuff that saved me. He scratches. Is he scratching the dome? Anyway, I needed to remember myself. It's said that the Necropolis can give anyone what they seek. Knowledge, riches, fame, if you search hard enough. And I searched, and I found. Now I'm here to help others with their answers. You look like you're searching for answers, too. There are hundreds, thousands of tombs in the Necropolis. Legend says if you read them, learn from them, that you'll find the answers you seek. He gives you a warm smile. I promise, it will be worth your while. And he thinks, you'll certainly find some answers, friend, even if they're not what you seek. Should I interpret that as threatening? Calistia says, one moment. You say you have searched these tombs. I have read of a certain symbol 8 concentric rings carved into the stone with beads within those channels and strings attached to those beads. It's some kind of stringed instrument, I believe. Have you ever seen such a thing? He taps his metal dome thoughtfully. You know? I think I may have. I may... have. He stares off into the distance. Try tomb code 3543. That seems like it might be the one. If you don't find it there, keep looking. Your answers will be down there somewhere. He smirks a little. And if you find anything you want to trade, let me know. Okay, we've got another code. I realize this is in our journal anyway, but... Calestige. And what is it? Some kind of symbol? Symbol. So, a symbol. Symbol. Instrument. Alright. Am I looking for a specific tomb? I'm gonna skip that for now. What is this tantalum metal anyway? Tell me. Stockular trading post. Huh. What is this tantalum metal anyway? It's one of the only metals that adheres to living flesh. Rare people like me, maybe only me, can turn that property on and off with the power of a thought. It's why I've got this built-in helmet now, and it lets me control my blades. My sword, for instance. He slaps the hilt, and you see that he wears no belt to anchor the blade. His knives are likewise anchored directly to his flesh. If I want the sword, I need but think on it, and it's in my hands. Likewise for the knives. And then, and this is the part I like, when I've buried him in an enemy, the blades are stuck there till I say it's time for him to go. Good thing this metal is bonded to respond only to me. If someone else can control it, why, I don't know what I'd do. He clamps his hands over the dome, protecting his brain. Honestly, I'd be running away holding this on. Can always find more swords, but I've only got one brain, at least as far as I can tell. His smile is a little harder. Some folks have tried to take this stuff from me to make it work for themselves. That didn't go well for them. Why is he going on and on about this? Is he, like, insecure about this stuff, or he's convinced we're going to try to take it from him? Or both? Tell me about the metal tantalum. Just a basic flesh-adhering metal that's controlled by your thoughts and desires? That's all. What can you tell me about the area? The whole place, this valley, it's been here for who knows how long. Someone came through and cleaned out all the life from the valley, and they made sure that nothing would ever grow up here again. Based on the bodies, I'm guessing the cultists don't bother you much. He nudges one of the corpses with his foot. They've tried a couple times. Once they even came to my tent at night and tried to cut my throat with my own blades. Idiots. My knives are made of tantalum and stuck to my flesh. And the cultists woke me. If they used the tools they'd brought, like normal murderers would, instead of being impressed by mine, I'd be dead now. As you can see, I'm not, and the situation's markedly different for them, too. He's funny. Every time they come for me, they wind up losing a few more of their carking number. I've left a fair number to rot here. He frowns. Seem to be taking their time disappearing, though. I figured at least the dust would scour them. Why are you standing around here? Waiting for any passerby that is seeking the truth like I was. I found my answer. I consider it my duty to help others find theirs. Waiting for seekers. I found my answer. I hope to help others find theirs. What do you have to trade?